Hi everyone. Today in this video we are going to discuss about Apixaban. How this drug acts as blood thinner? What is the mechanism of action? What are the important precautions, side effects and even drug interactions of Apixaban? All these things we will discuss in this video. What is Apixaban? The suffix "zaban" indicates this is one of the anticoagulant. We have another drug with similar suffix, rivaroxaban, which is again another anticoagulant related to Apixaban. These drugs can be used as blood thinners, particularly in the conditions where there is an elevated clot formation. Under few of the clinical conditions, there is an excessive clot formation. For instance, in case of deep vein thrombosis, DVT, and this DVT can be converted into pulmonary embolism, PE. And not only the pulmonary system, sometimes we can also observe the embolism within the systemic circulation. So systemic embolism, all these conditions may lead to stroke in the patients. So these are the clinical conditions where there is an excessive clot formation, which should be immediately dissolved in order to prevent the stroke and death in the patients. So Apixaban and rivaroxaban, these drugs are going to reduce the risk of clot formation and further stroke and death in the patients. So today in this video we will discuss about Apixaban. So one of the important clinical conditions is the deep vein thrombosis, DVT. So this is a condition where there is a formation of thrombus within the intima of the blood vessel. Suppose this is the blood vessel. At the larger blood vessels, a small clot is going to be formed. This is called as thrombus. And this thrombus is the abnormal clot formed by activation of the clotting factors, activation of the platelets, along with the fatty deposition of LDL cholesterol. All these can form thrombus formation. This thrombus can reduce the blood flow, thereby can reduce the blood supply. And this deep vein thrombosis can lead to another condition, pulmonary embolism. So when this thrombus is going to be broken and it is going to block the capillaries within the pulmonary circulation, it can reduce the blood flow such that it leads to pulmonary embolism. This pulmonary embolism is one of the emergency condition which should be immediately treated by dissolution of the clots and restoration of the blood flow. Otherwise, it may lead to stroke in the patients. So in all these conditions, the dissolution of the clot as well as thrombus is one of the important aspect. And sometimes we have the cardiovascular disorders like the atrial fibrillation can also increase the risk of stroke whenever the clots are going to be formed. After the surgery, again, there is a complication of clot formation. For example, in few of the surgeries like hip or knee replacement, the post-surgical complications may result in the deep vein thrombosis, which may lead to embolism in the patients if it is untreated. And finally, if you have the infections like the viral infections, can stimulate the immune system, and by stimulation of the T cells, they can produce the sudden surge of T cell stimulation resulting in the cytokine storm, which produce an inflammatory response. Again, they increase the clotting resulting in pulmonary embolism. COVID-19 infection is one of the example where it can increase the inflammation within the body by stimulation of T cells. This inflammatory response may result in the excessive clot formation, which may lead to pulmonary embolism. See, all these conditions are associated with the excessive clotting in the patients, which can be treated by using few of the blood thinners like Apixaban. One of the important clotting factor, both in the extrinsic as well as intrinsic pathway, is the factor 10, where both of the pathways are going to merge, leading to further coagulation cascade. So here factor 10 is present as an inactive precursor or zymogen, and which is going to be activated by other factors like the factor 8A, phospholipids as well as the calcium. These three can bind to this factor 10 along with the binding of factor 9A. So this complex will result in the activation of the factor 10 such that it is converted into factor 10A. So factor 10A is the active form of the factor 10, which is also called as Stewart factor. This factor 10A is having one of the target, that is the factor 2, which is also called as prothrombin. This prothrombin should be activated by factor 10A. For that, other factors are important. So one of the important clotting factors is a factor 5A along with phospholipids and calcium. Now these three can bind to the factor 10A, which can act on the prothrombin such that prothrombin is converted to thrombin. In this conversion, the prothrombin is bind to the factor 10A, where it is released as factor 2A, which is called thrombin. In this way, prothrombin is converted to thrombin or factor 2A by the factor 10A. Now, as the prothrombin is going to bind to the factor 10A, it can be converted to factor 2A so that a large amount of thrombin can be released, which is responsible for the conversion of fibrinogen into the fibrin meshwork. This fibrin is responsible for the formation of clot along with the platelets. It can arrest the blood flow. So normally in the tissue damage, the clot formed by fibrin meshwork can arrest the blood flow. But in few of the pathological conditions like deep vein thrombosis, pulmonary embolism, or post-surgical complications, or any viral infections like COVID-19, all this can increase the excessive clotting without any tissue damage, which can produce some stroke and death in the patients. In such conditions, we can use the blood thinners like the Apixaban. Now, this Apixaban inhibits the factor 10A, which is one of the important factor in this coagulation cascade. When this factor 10A is inhibited, it can prevent the clot formation and it can prevent the deep vein thrombosis and pulmonary embolism in the patients. That's why Apixaban can be used both for treatment as well as prophylaxis in case of deep vein thrombosis as well as pulmonary embolism. What are the precautions? One of the important precautions of Apixaban is that this drug, being a blood thinner, it can increase the risk of bleeding. So hemorrhage is one of the important precaution when this drug is going to be used. Normally this hemorrhage can be controlled, but when this Apixaban is given with the other drugs, which again produce the hemorrhage, it leads to the severe risk of bleeding. For example, when the warfarin is combined with the Apixaban, warfarin is another anticoagulant, which inhibits the vitamin K reductase enzyme that is actually responsible for the activation of the clotting factors like 2, 7, 9 and 10. So warfarin can inhibit the coagulation by inhibition of the activation of clotting factors. So it can also lead to the hemorrhage. Similarly, heparin is one of the IV anticoagulant which can also inhibit the factor 2A as well as 10A, thereby it can produce hemorrhage in the patients. Aspirin is one of the antiplatelet agent which can inhibit the synthesis of thromboxane A2. Thereby platelets are not activated and aggregated. So aspirin can also lead to the hemorrhage in the patients. Finally, if you have the fibrinolytics like urokinase, altiplase, utiplase, retiplase, all these drugs can also increase the risk of hemorrhage. So Apixaban should be carefully given and it should not be combined with the other anticoagulants as it leads to the severe bleeding in the patients. Similarly, if you have the drugs like SSRIs, such as fluoxetine, paroxetine, sertraline, escitalopram, all these are the selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors. And if you have the drugs like SNRIs, selective norepinephrine reuptake inhibitors, such as venlafaxine, duloxetine, milansipran, and similarly NSAIDs, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs like naproxene, diclofenac, ibuprofen, so many NSAIDs, all these category of drugs can increase the risk of bleeding. So when these drugs are simultaneously used, Apixaban can produce a severe bleeding in the patients. So this is one of the important precautions when the Apixaban is used. So either dose may be adjusted, otherwise alternative therapy may be initiated such that the risk of bleeding should be prevented. Another important precaution is that Apixaban is going to be used to reduce the risk of stroke in the patients. But when this drug is going to be discontinued after a few days, what happens? If no other anticoagulant is prescribed after discontinuation of the Apixaban and still there is a risk of formation of stroke in the patients, then discontinuation of apixaban may lead to the thrombosis in the patients. This thrombosis may lead to the embolism, and finally it can lead to increased risk of stroke in the patients. So this drug should not be suddenly stopped, and whenever this drug is going to be discontinued, it should be thoroughly assessed that the patient is having the less risk of thrombosis as well as embolism. Otherwise, discontinuation of apixaban therapy may lead to the unwanted thrombosis in the patients. So use of the apixaban is a sensitive balance between the hemorrhage as well as thrombosis. So proper use of apixaban can reduce both the risk of bleeding as well as risk of thrombus formation. What are the side effects? As we have discussed earlier, the important side effect of apixaban is the hemorrhage. It leads to the bleeding, and another one, it can also produce hypersensitive reactions like anaphylactic reactions, which should be thoroughly monitored. Drug interactions. This is very important because coagulation is a sensitive balance. So any other drugs may influence the action of apixaban, which may lead to the either increased risk of bleeding, otherwise increased risk of thrombosis. So these drug interactions should be thoroughly checked when this apixaban is co-administered with other therapeutic drugs. Particularly, drug interactions are observed at the pharmacokinetic parameters. This apixaban can be converted to metabolites within the liver by cytochrome P450, and among them CYP3A4 is one of the important metabolic enzyme. Similarly, apixaban is excreted through the renal system, and it is a substrate for one of the pump P-glycoprotein, which is an efflexing pump which can increase the secretion of apixaban into the renal tubules. Now, few of the drugs like ketoconazole, itraconazole, ritonavir, clarithromycin, all these drugs are the strong inhibitors of CYP3A4. So they are going to inhibit this enzyme, thereby they inhibit the metabolism of apixaban. Similarly, these drugs are going to inhibit the P-glycoprotein, thereby they can inhibit the renal excretion of this drug. So by all of these effects, the serum levels of apixaban are elevated, which increase the risk of bleeding. So whenever these drugs are co-administered, the dose of the apixaban should be reduced in order to reduce the risk of bleeding. Similarly, if you have the drugs like carbamazepine, rifampin, phenytoin and phenobarbital, all these drugs are the metabolic enzyme inducers. They can induce the CYP3A4 enzyme, as well as they can also induce the P-glycoprotein pump, so that the apixaban levels within the serum are going to be reduced. So in such situation, there will be a failure of treatment, which lead to the increased risk of clotting formation. So in presence of these drugs, apixaban should be avoided because it cannot prevent the clot formation within the patients. So these drug interactions should be thoroughly checked when this apixaban is going to be administered. Now let us the structure of apixaban. So this is the structure of apixaban, and here we can observe a fused heterocyclic ring system. So let us start the numbering here. This is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So here pyrazole ring is fused with the pyridine ring system. So apixaban is having the pyrazolopyridine ring system. Now let us see how apixaban acts. How it is given? This drug is given as a tablet form. It is available at 2.5 mg as well as 5 mg. The initial dose is given at 5 mg twice daily. But in few of the patients who are having the body weight less than or equal to 60 kg, otherwise in the elders with age greater than 80 years, and in the patients who are having the serum creatinine level greater than 1.5 mg per deciliter, which indicates the renal functionality. So in those patients who are having some renal dysfunction, in all these people, the dose should be reduced. So the dosage adjustment should be done such that the initial dose is 2.5 mg twice daily. In this way, the apixaban should be carefully used, and in few of the people, the dose should be reduced. And even the drug interaction should be thoroughly checked. And in case of those drugs which are going to increase the serum levels of apixaban, there will be a risk of bleeding, so dose should be reduced. Similarly, in those category of drugs which are going to reduce the levels of apixaban, it may lead to the failure of treatment, So in such situations, apixaban may be avoided. But apixaban can be used in the treatment as well as prophylaxis of deep vein thrombosis, pulmonary embolism, or even conditions like the stroke, which are associated with the non-valvular atrial fibrillation. In all these conditions, apixaban can be used even after post-surgical complications. This drug can be given when there is a risk of thrombus and embolus formation. But being an anticoagulant, this drug should be carefully given in order to prevent the hemorrhage in the patients. And this drug should not be suddenly stopped. And even after discontinuation of this therapy, there may be an increased risk of thrombosis and stroke formation in the patients, which should be thoroughly checked. So that's about this apixaban, which acts as blood thinner. Hope you have enjoyed this video. If you like this video, please subscribe to our channel. Share this video with your friends. Post your comments in the comment box. Thank you for watching this video.